Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. If you are always here, or if this is your first time, if you're listening on the web or the CD, welcome. Welcome into this community of faith. Welcome into this community of love. The announcements are as in the order of service, but there are a couple to draw your attention to. Unfortunately, the social group are having to cancel the night on the 4th of November. This is due to it clashing with the fireworks in the village. It's a real shame, but I have been assured that they will come back with something hugely exciting and wonderful in the new year. There is going to be a holiday club next week for primary fours to primary sevens, and it's going to be in the morning. There is a notice board through in the Chalmers suite giving you all the details. If you have any questions, please speak to Linda. Everyone is welcome. Linda, if you could wave your hand so everyone can see you. It's Linda there. And a couple of late notices as well. There will be a guild fundraiser on Tuesday, the 1st of November. It is a night at the silent movies, and Laurel and Hardy, A Fine Mess, will be being shown, and our own Forrester will be accompanying on the piano. Tickets are available in the Chalmers Hall this week, next week, and the following Sunday, and can be got from Dorothy. Dorothy, if you could wave your hand so everyone can see you. The yellow coat there. The other late notice is a thank you to all who joined in and supported the Walk for Children in Need yesterday. So far, £115 has been raised. So well done, all of you. Today, we are going to be thinking about why we do things as we do in church and during a Sunday service. So I'm going to try to explain most of what we do and why we do it. I'll do a good bit of it during the sermon, but some of it I'll do as we go. But now, let us take a moment to still ourselves and get ourselves ready and in the right mind to worship Almighty God. Journeying through life, looking for meaning, we gather. We wander in our own wilderness, and still we come. We gather. We seek God. We are here. Just as we are, we come to worship God. We stand as we are able, singing together hymn 184. Sing to the Lord a joyful song.
Thank you.
if we are looking at what we do, we have done an awful lot up to yet. But a couple of things to look at. The Bible came in. We had some announcements. We then had a call to worship. We then sung a song. And we are about to pray. So why do we carry the Bible in the way that we did? Well, we are acknowledging the centrality of the Bible in our service of worship. We're not worshiping the Bible. We're not saying that the paper and the gold and the vellum of the book in themselves are holy. But what we are saying is that we are recognizing that the Bible reveals the very character of God to us. And in all we do, we are seeking to emulate the life of Jesus and the character of God as we understand it revealed in the Bible. So that is why we start with the Bible coming in. It's why I pause with the Bible. And it's why at the end, the similar thing is reversed for the Bible going out. We then have the announcements. We have them because we are a community of people. And we have things that we're doing in the community, and it's important that we all know about them. But we have them before the call to worship, because they're not part of worshiping God in themselves. The service proper itself starts with that call to worship. It kind of sets the scene. It's a signal to us to ready ourselves to move into the period of more formal service. That's not dull and fancily dressed formal. But that's a time of prayers and songs and hearing from the Bible and trying to understand the Bible and how it all fits into our life and faith. The call of worship calls us to do something. Worship is not something that we watch or something that happens around us. Worship, to worship, is a verb. It's something we do. Worship is about engaging with God and seeking God and meeting with God. And we've sung a song. In the Bible, there are lots of examples of people singing to God and singing about God. Songs of praise and joy and anger and questioning. There are lots of different types of songs, but singing together helps us feel connected as a community. And songs tap into our emotions in ways that words sometimes don't. And now we come to pray. At this point, we are speaking to God. We are looking to God and giving thanks for all that God is. And we're saying sorry for all that we've got wrong. At different times, we do it in different ways, but that's what we do. And at this part of the service, we also have the Lord's Prayer. A prayer that encapsulates much of what Jesus taught, and it's what Jesus taught us to pray. So that's what we do. Praying together unifies us in spirit and in purpose, connecting us when we pray together to each other, but also connecting us to God. Let us pray. God in heaven, as we think about why we do what we do, we look to you. We thank you for all that we have, all that is good and helpful, all that is kind and honest, all that is comforting and filled with hope. We thank you for this as we know it comes from you. And we say sorry. We have got it wrong. We have actively done things that hurt other people. We have hurt other people's by doing nothing. And in hurting other people, we hurt ourselves and we hurt you. Please forgive us. We are sorry. We know that when we say sorry, and when we mean it, that you forgive us. And when we are forgiven, and when we forgive, we know that relationships are mended and old wounds are healed. When we are forgiven, we are given a chance to start again and to try to make the world a more just and loving place. God, we come and speak to you together, saying in community the words that Jesus taught as printed in the order of service. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Can anyone see something in the church that they've not seen this morning? Do you want to point at it? But you've seen most. We'll come back to them and we'll see which ones of those you have seen. But the totalizer. Do you remember what, or do you think you know what this might be about? Just say it out. To see how much food we've collected. Collected for Startup Sterling. Yep. And can you remember why that we're keeping a total of what we've collected? No. It's because we're going to see if we can raise a ton of food in 12 months. And we started this at our harvest service 2 weeks ago. And each can that goes on here represents 50 kilograms of food. And we already have 5 cans in our first week. So thank you to all of you and all of the other boys and girls in the Sunday school and all of you who brought donations to give to Startup Sterling. In our first week, we raised 250 kilograms of food. It's a wonderful thing. And it's got us a quarter of the way to the ton. It's unlikely that we are going to raise 250 kilograms of food every week. But if we all bring a bit every now and again, and when we have Sundays where we've announced beforehand that we want to have a good push to help them because they're short of things, then I think we can very easily reach that tons target and maybe raise far, far more. So this is going to be sometimes in the church, and if it's not in the church, it will be in the vestibule of the Chalmers Hall, so we can always see how we're getting on. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing all the cans stack up and then burst out the top. But we'll see how long it takes. In the reading that we're going to have later in the service, we're going to hear about Jesus going into the temple, a place where people came to meet with God. And when he was in the temple, Jesus got angry. He got angry because there was people using things in the temple, or it would be a church as we might understand it, to try and make money. They were taking the time when people were looking to God, and they were selling things and changing money and using that to take advantage of people. And Jesus said that this was not on. He said that the temple, the church, is to be a place of prayer, a house of prayer, a place where people meet with God in prayer and in songs and in words and in all sorts of different ways. And that's why this morning we are looking at what we do in church. So we're looking at what we do and making sure that we're doing it for the right reasons and not for the wrong reasons. Now, there's some things here which we might talk about. But do you have any questions about things that we might do in church that you don't understand? And we'll maybe see if we can answer. Yes, Naomi. you just want to hear about the colourful scarves? Yeah. So you notice that you maybe haven't seen some of these before. So you will have seen some of them. I could think of three at least that you may have seen. But can you remember what these are? Just say it out loud. They're the scarves. They're my preaching scarves. And they come in different colours. So I tend to wear them just at special occasions in the church. But you can, there's different ones to wear at all occasions in the church. So each one is kind of connected with kind of something that we feel or do or an emotion that we have in the seasons of the church. But also we can wear them for special occasions when we're particularly feeling something. So what sort of things do you think you feel that it's good that we can express in church? Or do you want to pick a colour and then we can explain what that one's about? So which colour do you want to start with? Yes, Daniel? Green. The green one. It's quite big. Do you want to put it on? No. Okay. So the green one. The green one we wear during a period in sort of what might be called the liturgical year, kind of the church year, that you'd wear at what's called ordinary time. But it's just for when things are normal, when things are just happening, when things are not too bad, not too good, they're just okay. So we have something in the church, a colour that we wear, not all the time, but sometimes we wear these colours, to say things are okay, it's just kind of normal. So if we have stuff for when things are okay, that means we must have things for other things. So what colour do you want to look at? Yeah? Red. We'll put this back over. I won't put them all on. The red one is when we do things that are especially full of the Holy Spirit. So for things like ordinations, so that's what happened to me in January of this year, when people become ministers or they become elders or deacons. But also when we talk about the Holy Spirit in Pentecost coming to join the church and forming the church, that's when we have the red one. So it's those kind of special, very kind of Holy Spirit occasions. So that's red and then green. Should we just, which one next? The multicolored one. That's the rainbow one. Not everywhere has rainbow colors, but I have a rainbow colored one. And that's for, I wear that the same time as I wear the white one, which is for big celebrations. So it would be for baptisms and communions and Christmas and Easter and just things where you want to be joyous. So that's the multicolored one and the white one as well. And that leaves us one left, which is the purple one. So we've had everything kind of being okay, and we've had things being brilliant and as having sort of celebrating things, and we've had the particularly kind of special churchy kind of times. So what kind of thing do we not have yet? Sad. Yep. So we have the purple one for things when are sad and difficult, or when we are preparing for something. So in the run-up to Easter, when we're thinking about the problems and the death of Jesus, we would wear purple. But when we are remembering and having people and celebrating the lives of people who we have loved when they have died, we would, and at funerals, we would wear the purple ones. So in all that we do as church, there is some kind of symbolism in what we're wearing and why we're wearing it. And maybe in the other, and in all the other things too, there is as well. But I quite like the scarves and the colours that they have, because it certainly tells me that in all points, at all emotions, whether however very happy or very sad, the church is there and there with you in that. But it's good to think about us being church and what we do. And the church is not just something that happens here. It happens in all sorts of places. It's not just a building, it is people. And we're going to sing about that now. Standing as we are able, singing hymn 522. The church is wherever God's people are praising. Please be seated. Let us pray together. God, thank you that the church is with us, whether things are happy or sad. Thank you that we can think through the things that we do. Thank you for the week of holiday that's coming. We ask your blessing on the holiday club as it meets. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Reading for this Sunday is Matthew chapter 21, verses 12 to 17, and it is page 989 in the Pew Bibles. Verse 12, Jesus at the temple. Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, replied Jesus, have you never read? From the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise. And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. Amen.
Thank you, Gwen. It would be remiss of me this morning not to mention Hurricane Matthew. This is a deeply tragic and horrific natural disaster. It was not punishment by God. But the work of God and the love of God is found in the responses to those who have been affected. Where people are fed and housed, where compassion is shown, where people are loved and helped without asking questions as to whether it is deserved. That is the work of God. Extreme weather events have always been a part of the history of the world, but they are starting to get more frequent. And this is because humanity is abusing the earth. Man-made climate change is causing more extreme and dangerous weather, but we can do something about it. Being more careful and intentional about the way we use the natural resources of the earth, and holding our governments and our industries to account for the way they use natural resources too. When these disasters happen, when disasters of any form happen, God is found not in the destruction, but in the love that is rebuilding. Let us find ways to be part of that rebuilding. We stand together and sing once more. Hymn 680, Standing As You Are Able. You are called to tell the story.
You are called to tell the story.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen. It might seem odd to look at what we do in church. For many of us, these are things that have gone on every Sunday for as long as we can remember. You might think you know why we do what we do, but it's easy to get complacent. It's easy to think because we've always done something, then it is right. It's not wrong to continue doing what we have always done. It's not wrong to change. But what is wrong is not looking at what we are doing and why we are doing it. In the passage we read today, Jesus shows his anger at those who are exploiting and profiteering from religion. And I'm sure that those whose tables Jesus flipped, would not think themselves as doing that. They were doing what maybe seemed reasonable. They are doing what they had done for a long time. They're pretty much had I been. But to look at it from the outside, it clearly wasn't right. They were overcharging for doves to be used in the temple sacrifices. And they were overcharging at the money exchange. You had to have the perfect animal to sacrifice, as that was truly a sacrifice. And sacrifice at that point was about renewing your covenant, your relationship with God. And to get into the temple, you needed to pay the temple tax. But it was only payable in a certain currency and a certain coinage, which you had to buy at the temple. These things will have started off as helping, but without scrutiny over time, they became exploitative and oppressive. Jesus saw this and lost his temper. We should look at our own practices. The ways that we be church. The ways that we live our own lives. And question if what we are doing would cause Jesus to lose his temper. A simple way of holding ourselves to account is us knowing why we do what we do. What we should be doing in everything is in our ability to make church and worshiping God as inclusive and accessible as possible, allowing everyone a place at the table and an ability to join in the act of worshiping God. That is, we should be a house of prayer where people can engage with God and celebrate and commiserate and laugh and cry together. Let us look briefly at the rest of what we will be doing in the service and how that fits together. And then we will come to the other things that we can do or could do. Obviously, within our service, we have a Bible reading. And this is because we view the Bible as containing the Word of God. Word there has a very definite and intentional capital W. We are not saying the words of God, but the Word. It's translated from the Greek logos, which means logic or plan or reasoning. The Word tells us about who God is, both through the experience of humanity in the Old Testament and through the retelling of significant parts of the life of Jesus and the working out what all that means after his death and resurrection in the New Testament. As an interesting aside, as we look at our Bibles, the chapters and the verses that we see were finalized and put in place in the 16th century. And those headings that we find that are sometimes very helpful, but sometimes not that helpful, they are put there by the translators as they compile the Bible in our own time. but back to the bones of our service. We have a sermon, some form of preaching or teaching in our service. Our normal pattern, we also have an all-age slot, which includes preaching and teaching. Teaching is key to understanding what's going on in the Bible. Knowing context and the application of that to our daily lives is a key part of how we live out our faith. And that is why all ministers in the Church of Scotland are educated to at least degree level in divinity or theology, and are expected to continue studying throughout their lives. There's an interesting point about where we preach from, here up in the pulpit, although pulpits are not always used. There is nothing hugely significant about the use of a pulpit, other than it is a good orator's tool. It allows those gathered to hear and to see better. It is often supposed that the height is about honouring the word of God. But that's not true. The little bit of height that honours the word of God is found in the chancel or the dais or the bit of the front, however you describe it, where there is often one or two steps up. And whilst we're thinking about the building and the way that we're structured, pews. Are pews biblical? No. Are they comfortable? Certainly not here. Are they a good way of sitting a large number of people in a space? Certainly. Are they an important part of our cultural heritage? Arguably, yes. And stained glass. It's there with other parts of church architecture to tell the biblical accounts without words, imparting biblical truths and stories through pictures. They also look really pretty. If you look in the furthest back left-hand pane on that side, you will see the depiction of the story that we have had this morning. Jesus in the temple with a cord driving out the money changers and the dove sellers. But let us get back to more about how we are as church. There are simple things that are more about including rather than excluding. The use of microphones and speakers and the loop system. The use of a clear font in the order of service. And the printing of the Lord's Prayer in the order. So that we are not assuming that everyone knows it or remembers it. For us as a church, our access for those with mobility issues is okay. But we could be better. Our internal signage, similarly, is okay. But could be better. It's very important that we look at what we do, and without fault or without blame, look at where we can do what we do better, making our church a place of prayer that is more accessible and inclusive. What we have to actively look at is what we do and why we do it. If we do it for reasons that help us engage with God, then good. We keep doing it, and we should be trying to do it better. If we do it because of tradition, then that's fine. There's no reason to stop it, as long as it doesn't impede and hinder our acts of worship. Let us think about what we do, both in church and in our lives. Let us look intentionally at what we do, trying to understand why we do things in the way that we do them. Let us look at these things with the intentions of making our church and our lives more of a house of prayer than it ever was before. Sometimes when we sing, the words of the song speak to us more than anything else. Let us stand as we are able, singing together hymn 198. Let us build a house where love can dwell. Building a house where love can dwell, we are building a house where all are welcome. In the face of what is potentially concerning rhetoric coming out of the British government in the last week, I would like to make it completely clear that here in Bridge of Allan Parish Church, we align completely with the inclusive nature of the love of God and can say very, very clearly, all are welcome. It doesn't matter where you were born. It doesn't matter your accent or the colour of your skin. It doesn't matter how you self-identify or how others identify you. It doesn't matter who you love or who loves you. If you are here or anywhere else, you are welcome. You are loved. You are our neighbour and our sisters and brothers. All are welcome. Our offering will be uplifted whilst the choir sings the anthem, Thou Visiteth the Earth. This is the point in the service where we dedicate our offering and we lift our prayers for the world. These are not my prayers, but they are our prayers. In some traditions, the minister walks forward and says the prayers from within the aisle to emphasize that the prayers are coming from all the people. To put emphasis on this morning, I'm going to do something that I think is very good, but we've not done here since I've been here. I'm going to ask you all to contribute, not everybody, but those of you who are comfortable to contribute to the prayers, by before we start, giving me a name, a place, a situation that you would like to be included in the prayers. Please do not disclose any confidentialities. A simple name or situation will suffice. God will know and hear the prayer. If you don't feel you can say anything, God will still know and hear the prayers that you have. Even if you can't find the words, God knows and understands the groans of your heart. And silence will be left in the prayer. So I ask you, what situations would you like to be prayed for this morning? Syria.
Haiti.
Haiti.
Family in South Africa.
The nurse with Ebola.
Thank you. those in hospices.
Families supported by children in need.
Let us pray. Generous God, we give thanks for all that you have provided for us. Receive these offerings. We bring them to you and ask that you use them for the wider work of our church. Let them be a sign and a symbol of our lives, which we offer to you once more this day. Take us and use us too, for the sake of your kingdom here and now. And God, we cry out. We cry out for those in Haiti who've lost their houses, who've lost loved ones, who've lost all they have. For those across the wider Caribbean hit by Hurricane Matthew. For those affected around the world by disaster or something that strips them of their homes. We ask that they can find comfort and relief, that we can somehow find a way to feed them and to provide them shelter. We pray for the situation in Syria, the ongoing and difficult conflict. We cry out for peace. We are running short of words. Hear us as we groan. We thank you for those who give of themselves to help others. The nurse who contracted Ebola in helping those who were ill. We thank you for her and all who gave of themselves in that situation. We ask for your healing. For all those who heal and for all those who suffer. We pray for those in hospices, for those who are coming to the end of their earthly life, for those who look after them. For the families and friends whose hearts are breaking. Thank you that we can support people in this desperate need. Strengthen those who are hurting. Comfort those who mourn. We pray for those who are in need, who are supported by Startup Sterling, who are supported by the funds raised by children in need. We ask that we can help and work towards a country and a world where poverty is eradicated. But as it is still here, help us to help those in need. Help us to encourage and support the helpers. Lord, we pray for our armed forces. People doing a difficult job and making difficult decisions. trying to bring about peace. We ask that in the turmoil and the pain and the post-traumatic stress and the horror of all that they see, they can find comfort. They can find you. They can find a way of peace being wrought. Help your chaplains as they help those in the forces. Lord, our hearts are full of prayers. Hear those we cannot say and that we dare not say. Hear the very groans of our being. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We stand and sing together once more, standing as we are able, singing hymn 511. Your hand, O God, has guided. As you think about why we do what we do, As you think about making your life more reflective of a house of prayer rather than a den of robbers. As you are filled with words of sending and thoughts of your own mind. As you go into the world, may the peace of Christ go with you, wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness and protect you through the storms. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once more into his arms.